the robots that explored the solar system. The promise I make to all of you is that this talk will take you through our solar system, teach you a bit about each planet, and explain a little about how we learned what we know and the remarkable robots that have brought us to places no human could ever go. Places where the pressure from the air on the surface would crush you, or where there is no surface, just an enigmatic and impenetrable deepening of the solid liquid gases of the gas giant planets far from the sun. Nothing will ever land on Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, or Neptune. I was born in Vancouver in 1983, and I lived on the traditional ancestral unceded territory of the Coast Salish, Musqueam, Tsleil-Waututh, Stolo, and Squamish peoples near Trout Lake in North Vancouver and on the campus of the University of British Columbia. After I finished my BA in 2005, I lived for 2 years in Oxford in the United Kingdom, where I studied international relations and the politics of the environment. I then worked for 5 years for the federal government in Ottawa, which is built on unceded Algonquin Anishinaabe territory. Since 2012, I have been working on a PhD in political science at the University of Toronto, which is on the traditional land of the Huron-Wendat, the Seneca, and the Mississaugas of the Credit. I am researching university students who are protesting to get their universities to stop investing in fossil fuel corporations. When I was 11 years old, I went with a friend to the Vancouver Planetarium to see Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 crash into Jupiter. It was amazing to think that across this enormous distance, we could watch and understand what was happening. Watching science shows on TV, like Carl Sagan's Cosmos, taught me more about the planets. And eventually I learned about the field of planetary science and the work that planetary scientists like Sagan and colleagues around the world have been doing for over 50 years. So, how did people who studied the nature of the universe learn about the solar system and the ways each of the planets are unique worlds of their own? Indigenous peoples have observed and sought to explain the objects in the sky since before recorded history. In 1979, in a cave in Germany, what is believed to be the oldest star chart was found, carved on a sliver of mammoth tusk. It is estimated to be 32,500 years old. The word planet comes from ancient Greek and means wanderers. People who looked at the sky observed that most of the stars behaved like they are part of a fixed dome, always staying in the same place relative to each other as the globe turns and the sun rises and sets. They stay in the patterns people describe as constellations. The planets, however, took their own complicated paths across the sky from season to season and year to year. The ancient Greeks recognized Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn in the sky. When Galileo turned his telescope upward in the early 1600s, he discovered that planets were more than just points of light. He saw how Venus went through phases like the moon does, and saw that Jupiter has moons of its own. Uranus was discovered by William Herschel in 1781, Neptune was discovered in the mid-1800s, and Clyde Tombaugh discovered Pluto in 1930. Interestingly, it was the Czech writer Karel Čapek who coined the term robot in 1920 to refer to an artificial human being. Sasha, Micah, and my mother, Alena, was born in Prague, which is now in the Czech Republic. Real people are too delicate and have too many needs to go into deep space. So except for the tiny area around the Earth and Moon, only robots have explored the outer solar system. Still, there's the old astronomer joke, "Welcome to the solar system. You've been here all your life." Nothing made by a human being ever went into orbit before the Soviet Union launched Sputnik 1 in 1957. Because of the Cold War political climate, and because a rocket that can put a robot in space can also launch a nuclear bomb anywhere on Earth, Sputnik began what was called the space race. The USA launched their first artificial satellite, Explorer 1, a year later, and Canada's Alouette 1 was launched on an American rocket from a military base in California. Starting from here, we can begin our exploration of the solar system. This photo from Voyager 1 was taken in 1977 and was the first ever to show the entire Earth and Moon together in space. No human has ever been this far from Earth. Right here together now, we're about to go a whole lot farther. Every space launch is an expensive project with a lot of risk. Sometimes rockets explode without going anywhere, destroying what they were meant to carry and everything near them. For that reason, every robot we send into space is built and tested in pristine conditions inside a special clean room. People wear bunny suits to keep from getting anything from their own bodies, sweat, hair, or an eyelash, inside a scientific instrument meant to study distant planets, or on part of a spacecraft that will need to function through the total frigidness, airlessness, and radiation of space. If anything goes wrong from start to finish on a robotic mission, it can mean the end of everything. In 1687, in his Principia Mathematica, Isaac Newton described the laws of motion. The first law says that an object in motion will remain in motion, and an object at rest will stay at rest. When the Voyager missions were given the energy they needed to escape the Earth and eventually the solar system by the rockets that launched them, they were put on trajectories that nothing will ever stop. They will keep flying until the end of the universe. The moment of launch is always a nerve-wracking, white-knuckle time for everyone who cares about a space mission. Voyager was launched on an American missile underneath an enormous protective shell called a fairing to protect the fragile spacecraft while the rocket pushes through the atmosphere and accelerates to orbital velocity. To stay in space, you need to fly sideways around the Earth about 8 kilometers every second. To explore the solar system, let's begin with the sun. It's 1.39 million kilometers away and 330,000 times the mass of the Earth. Of all the mass in the solar system, 99.86% is in the sun. Inside the sun, hydrogen, which is the simplest chemical element, is forced together by immense gravity. That nuclear fusion reaction produces nearly all the energy on Earth. We get it directly as sunlight, but it also powers the wind and the weather. It makes all the plants on Earth grow. So when we burn the coal, oil, and gas that geologists believe formed millions of years ago from the bodies of ancient plants and animals, we are really releasing the energy of ancient sunlight. Known since prehistoric times, Mercury is the closest planet to the sun. A year there lasts just under 90 days, but nobody could survive for a year because Mercury is too small and too hot to hold an atmosphere. The temperatures there range from negative 173 degrees Celsius, which is so cold that air would freeze solid, to over 400 degrees Celsius, which is hot enough to cook a pie. Only two robots have ever been sent to Mercury, but Europe and Japan have a joint mission on the way, which will arrive in 2025. While Mercury has no atmosphere, Venus has too much. Venus has different ways to kill you. Back in the 1960s, scientists hoped that the planet might have the conditions for life, since it is fairly near the Earth in size and location. It has an atmosphere with 90 times the mass and surface pressure of the Earth. So anyone who stood there would be crushed like a soda can dropped to the bottom of the ocean. The atmosphere is also more than 96% carbon dioxide, which traps heat. As a result, the surface is always over 450 degrees Celsius. Every robot we have sent to land on Venus has melted within a few hours. That may be too pessimistic a way to put it, though. Robots have landed on Venus. The first was the Venera 3 space probe launched by the Soviet Union in 1966. This is the first photo ever taken on the surface of another world by the Venera 9 lander. Less than an hour after it landed, it stopped working because of Venus's incredible heat. I'm not going to talk much about the Earth, except to say that it is without question the most important place in the solar system that we have ever learned about with robots in space. We look at the Earth in a completely different way from people who have never seen it all at once from a top-down view. And thousands of satellites now watch the planet every day, doing everything from helping us predict the weather to using tiny changes in the strength of the gravity of the planet below to map ice sheets. Like with Venus, people once hoped that Mars might be a place with life of its own or where people could live. In fact, The way Earth and Mars are so similar is why most of the missions which have been sent in search of extraterrestrial life have gone there. NASA and international partners now land rovers the size of SUVs on Mars. Mars has the worst kind of atmosphere for a spacecraft trying to land because it is too thin for parachutes, but thick enough to cause enormous heating as the spacecraft. Mars has the worst kind of atmosphere for a spacecraft trying to land because it is too thin for parachutes, but thick enough to cause enormous heating as the spacecraft hits it at orbital velocity. Remember that 8 kilometers per second that we had to put in with a rocket to speed away from the Earth? That energy needs to go someplace, and most of it goes to superheating the thin atmosphere of Mars around the lander as it plunges toward the surface. NASA invited anyone in the world to have their name written in tiny letters on silicon chips attached to the Perseverance rover. If you would like your name on another planet, you can sign up for the next one online. Robotic missions to Mars often cannot rely on solar panels because they are already getting so far away from the sun. Rovers like Perseverance use a kind of nuclear battery where warm decaying plutonium produces a small but reliable amount of electricity. Moving out into the outer solar system, the realm of the gas giants, every mission before Juno ran on radioactive power. Juno is an unusual mission in several ways. It is principally meant to study Jupiter's magnetic field, and so, because it doesn't need to point in a consistent direction to aim cameras, it can be spun to keep it stable. Citizen scientists have been able to produce amazing images of Jupiter using the camera on the side of the spinning spacecraft. There's a speck on the right of this image, which is Jupiter's moon Io. Just like his namesake as the king of the gods for the ancient Greeks, Jupiter's vast gravity has captured a huge collection of moons. Some of them might be the homes of alien organisms. Saturn's gravity has torn apart small nearby moons into fabulous rings which have fascinated astronomers for centuries. Cassini is the robot that took this photograph. When its scientific life was done, scientists thought it was so important to avoid any risk of contaminating a potentially life-bearing moon like Enceladus that the robot was crashed into the massive and devastating atmosphere of Saturn, where scientists watched its data feeds as it burned up. Why were they so careful? This is water spraying out into space from geysers on the frozen surface of Enceladus, one of Saturn's moons. The sun is 100 times dimmer than at Earth, but there are probably volcanoes underground that keep an ocean of water liquid, insulated by a cracked layer of shifting ice. Many bodies in the solar system with atmospheres and magnetic fields have auroras of the sort observed and studied in the Northwest Territories. Here we see auroras on the distant planet Uranus, as well as one of the rings which it pulled together for itself by gravity. By the time you get to Uranus, the sun is only 1/400th as bright as on Earth. The planet is basically an enormous ball of slushy gases, just like Jupiter, Saturn, and Neptune. Remember Voyager 1, the spacecraft which we saw in the clean room before, the one with a trajectory departing the Earth before flinging far out into the outer solar system? This is the photo that Voyager sent back from Neptune in 1989, when it had flown there across the vast expanses of the solar system. People, scientists and engineers and precision manufacturing specialists and metallurgists and computer programmers worked together to make this robot, to put a camera in a box and fling it all the way out to Neptune and beyond with a rocket. It will never stop racing away from the Earth, following Newton's first law that an object in motion remains in motion. Remember me at the beginning as an 11-year-old astronomy nerd watching a comet crash into an alien planet using a telescope in space? That was the Hubble Space Telescope, which is still up there doing science. In recent years, I have watched with amazement as the New Horizons spacecraft explored Pluto close up on a ballsy all-or-nothing mission to get the science in one pass. This is a story of what you can accomplish despite being small. The whole New Horizons robot was about the size of a small piano. Plutonium had kept it from completely freezing in the near total darkness in the far reaches of the outer solar system. At precise moments, it had to follow a pre-programmed sequence. Far off in space, it had to spin and flip and point each scientific instrument at areas of interest on Pluto and Charon, its enormous and equally mysterious moon. They studied the moons and the atmosphere, mountains of frozen gases as tall as the Rockies, and actually only as old, showing that instead of an unchanging ice ball, Pluto is still a dynamic world, out in the dark where the sun is just a bright star. And here's what they got with the New Horizons mission. I cried when I saw these images because it was so satisfying to see a mission that took decades succeed and take us all to an amazing new place, which is so much more complex and interesting than we ever knew. I cried on Christmas morning 2021 too, with relief when the James Webb Space Telescope launched successfully to Earth orbit, beginning the most complex portion of its own journey into one of space's strangest places, a place where gravity all just balances out and you can just shield yourself from the sun on one side to keep your science instruments ultra cold. The telescope hasn't produced its first scientific images yet, but the process of minutely coordinating all the mirrors has produced an engineering photo that should take your breath away. Those are galaxies, and the light from them has taken 3 billion years to travel across space for us to see it. The ancients hoped that they could see the future in the sky, but all we will ever see is the past, as light from ever more distant places reaches us across the cosmic vastness. There is more to come from the Webb telescope. Keep your eyes open, because the things we're going to see next will be amazing and will change how we think about our place in the universe and all the alien worlds around us with their mysteries and hidden depths. I'm going to wrap up, summarize what we've talked about, how you can learn more, and what a value you have already seen. If you want to see more about the solar system, just Google NASA's eyes on a phone or computer, and you can see an interactive model of planets, moons, and spacecraft. You can also see the Earth and the scientific missions around it. And using the SkyView Light app on your phone, just by pointing your phone at any object in the sky, it will tell you what it is. I'm very grateful to have had the chance to meet you a little and speak with you. I can promise something else in the conclusion, which is that what I have described is just the beginning. Thousands of brilliant people have devoted their lives to studying the planets using the information these robots have brought back for us. And I can tell you from experience that these people want to share. You can look at all the stuff they put online, sign up to have your name put on the next Mars rover, listen to their talks on YouTube, and correspond with them through social media. There are a lot of human astronauts on there too. I met Canadian astronaut Roberta Bondar at an event with Italian astronaut Samantha Cristoforetti and learned about the science Bondar did on the space shuttle and Cristoforetti did on the International Space Station. At another event, I saw principal investigator, which is a way bigger deal than you may think for a multi-million dollar space mission, Fran Baganal, talk about the New Horizons mission to Pluto and Juno mission to Jupiter. The love for exploration and depth of knowledge in that talk has been a lasting inspiration, and I hope that some of that has carried through today. The contribution which this talk has made is to introduce you all to the robotic exploration of the solar system. We have gone together from the sun to Pluto.